5, 4, 3, 2.
Welcome to the show known as Conversations in Monrovia. How are you doing today, Monrovia and beyond? I'm Ralph Walker, the host of the show. If you're a first-time person, a first-time individual viewing the show, you might wonder what it's all about. That is engaging in conversations that impact history, yesterday and today. In a whole lot of ways, we have been reviewing history due to Corona-19 virus that's been sweeping the nation and beyond. We found time to do what? Stop and think and review and look at history one more time. We may be given the opportunity to correct history in the same breath. Now, this is one of these shows that I've been working on for a very long time. I didn't know how it was going to come into fruition, but today we're going to make a little oral history, and I'm honored to have here in the studio today James Mikell, a 1958 Monrovia High School grad. How you doing today, sir?
Fine. How are you?
All right. Glad to have you here in the studio.
Glad to be here.
I got to lift your volume of your voice.
Okay. All right.
All right. So you graduated in 1958.
Yes, I did.
Monrovia High School.
Monrovia High School.
Well, let's go back a little bit. Your parents was born in Mississippi?
Mississippi.
What part?
My mother was born in Hattiesburg, and my daddy was born in Silver Creek.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that journey to Monrovia, how do you explain that to the viewers out there, from Mississippi to Monrovia?
Yeah, we came here when I was 5.
Okay.
And we moved right across the street from Huntington School. And so school was right across the street.
You couldn't miss a day, could you?
Couldn't miss a day.
So what was life like for your parents? Why did they move out of Mississippi? Did they explain it down the road? Or?
You know, my mother, she had graduated from Alcorn College in Hattiesburg.
Back in the day?
Back in the day. She had her teaching credentials.
Wow.
She came to California, and she couldn't get a job. She applied for it, but they wanted her to go back and get another degree, a California degree, because they didn't honor the Alcorn degree.
All right, the elimination process. We'll get you during the interview stage.
Okay.
All right, you have all these impeccable credentials. You probably could be a teacher, but in this day and age, we say no.
No, that's right.
You had to return back to school and do it all over again.
Yeah, and get a California credential.
Mm, so what did she do for employment?
Well, she's worked at day and night for a little while. They were making bombs, you know, shell casing for bombs.
Oh, okay.
And then she started doing day work. And my father, he worked at Herco's in Los Angeles. It's a steel plant where they made steel. And he worked there for a while, and then he got a job at Aerojet General.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and
aerospace industry.
Aerospace industry. He was started as a dishwasher, and he worked himself up to the head cook.
Okay.
Yeah, before he retired.
Making some progress.
Making progress.
So now, how did your mother deal with this? Here it is. She's an educated woman, highly educated, and unable to fulfill her dream of being a teacher.
Well, she took it in stride because there was nothing that she could do at that time. You know, no one to look forward to, you know, to ask questions about why she didn't get the job.
Yes, yes.
You know, so.
Accept no and move on.
Accept no and move on.
Now tell us about Mrs. Nellums, N-E-L-L-U-M-S.
Yes. She worked for Miss Nellums for a long period of time, and Miss Nellums told her that she would give her, if she passed, she would give her some of the property. They had a big lemon you know, Orchard out there.
Mm-hmm. And when, Glendora.
In Glendora. And when Ms. Nellum died, there was some discrepancies, and my mother didn't get anything.
Mm.
But my daddy had a Mr. Nellum's, before he passed away, he had this old Model T Ford.
Yes.
And so he gave it, she gave it to my daddy.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So they had a unique relationship,
yes,
I take it.
Yes, she loved my mother and my mother loved her.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she was honest.
Now, what do you think happened to the will?
The property, and mm-hmm. we don't know.
Now, have you ever heard anything from the family in the past?
No.
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 It was like when mom and dad died, that was the end.
Yeah, that was it.
Mm-hmm. All right. Tell me about growing up in Monrovia, Ron's Hot Dog Stand.
Oh, they had a sign right in front of the store, Colored's in the back. We had to go to the back if you wanted to get a hot dog.
Now, what year was that where we sat?
About 52.
Okay, 52.
Yeah, about 52.
So it was segregation greatly practiced in Monrovia.
Yes, yes. You couldn't go past Foothill if you were black, you know, at night.
Yeah.
Yeah. You couldn't move there anyway, you know.
All right, tell me about the movie theaters.
Well, the movie theater was segregated.
Okay, there was two movie theaters.
Yeah,
in
the Lyric.
The Lyric.
And the Monrovia.
And where is the Lyric located?
It was on Foothill.
Oh, that's trouble spot.
That's right.
So what happened if you went in there? You wanted to see a movie.
You couldn't get in.
Oh, they wouldn't let you in?
Oh, no. You could go to the Monrovia because they had the matinee on Saturday. You could go there, you know, in the morning, you'd be there all day, but you couldn't go to the Lyric Theater on Foothill.
They tore it down first before they kept it up, huh?
Right, right.
All right, everyone knows about this Monrovia famous parrot that used to be in a store.
Yeah.
Right across from the recreation park.
Yeah, Miss Basotis.
Miss Basotis.
Yeah.
What type of person was she?
She was older,
mm-hmm.
and she was nice. And her son, he ran the gas station. They had a gas station. And they had, that's when they had gas. You could see the gas in the little dome.
Yes.
On top. And we would go to this in the store, and Miss Basotti had this parrot.
Whose parrot was?
It was her parrot.
Oh, she was a nice lady though, huh?
Yeah, she was nice.
But that parrot wasn't too
nice, was it?
And he used to echo out some interesting phrases,
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Such as?
Niggas are stealing. You know, and she'd look around and her son would come in to the store and say, what are you guys doing in here? You know, we weren't stealing.
Right.
You know, we were going in there to get some snacks.
So the parrot was a lookout bird.
He was a lookout bird.
Can a parrot distinguish color?
This one could.
Oh, that's a mindful.
Yeah.
All right. Now, if you just tuned in late and you're wondering what's taking place, I'm here with James Mikell, a 1958 Monrovia grad. We're going over some oral history in the history of Monrovia. You will only get this one time. All right, moving right along. Tell me about Mikell's barbecue joint.
Yeah, my father... We had a barbecue joint right there on the corner of Huntington Drive and Shamrock. And it was a nice, you know, a nice place. And this was right after the Korean War, and a lot of the soldiers,
yes,
you know, came in. And me and my friend, we used to play tricks on the soldiers because a lot of them, you know, was gunshot. And
post-traumatic stress, we would call it now.
Yeah, yeah. And we knew that, and so we'd go in and out the door and slam the door and watch them jump.
Oh, wasn't good kids.
No, it wasn't good kids. But the food was good.
The food was good. And the joint probably was jumping, huh?
Oh, yeah, because right next door to the barbecue place was Blanche's jukebox.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, juke joint.
What a combination.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Can't find a good rib joint around here now, huh?
No. But it was nice, and a lot of people would, you know, go up and down Huntington Drive, and the truck drivers would stop, and they would, you know, order. And my father was, you know, he was there, and it was a nice...
So what was the conversations like? What would people talk about?
Just any and everything. Any and everything. The soldiers would be talking about Blanche's Cafe, the women going in and out of Blanche's Cafe. Yes. You know, and they would, there's a parking lot, you know, and a lot of them, they'd be drinking out in the parking lot.
Yes, yeah.
And they'd talk about, you know, different things.
So pretty much black side of town.
Yeah, yeah.
A community within itself.
A community within itself.
Oh, wow, interesting. All right, tell me about the, it would be this spot right here, the armory.
Yeah, the armory, yeah. We would, as little boys, we couldn't get in.
Yes.
But we'd come up here and we'd see Johnny Otis, Big J McNeely, all of the guys that, you know, ushered in rock and roll.
Yes.
And we'd stand in the door and look and we'd watch them dance and they would...
Crowded?
Yeah, it was crowded. Always crowded. Always crowded.
And the music just blaring.
Yeah, the music was blaring. Johnny Otis, he'd bring his whole review here.
Mm.
You know, it was very nice.
Now tell me, you were a paper boy at one time?
Yes.
At the news post?
Monrovia News Post.
So you delivered the papers?
House to house? House to house on my bicycle.
So you covered a lot of territory.
I did.
Do you recall any amazing headlines? Or you didn't have time to read, you was just dropping the papers?
No, my mother was a teacher and insisted. You know, she said, read, because she said, if you read, you'll learn something.
Yes.
You know, and so I read the paper a lot. I remember they had a airplane crash in the foothills here. And there was a lot of people. It was an Air Force airplane that crashed. And they were looking for people to go up. You know, I was young at the time. I couldn't go, but... They were getting people to go up to bring the bodies out.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Crashed up here in the mountains?
In the mountains. Mm-hmm. In the mountains. And then they had the fair used to come through here, big time, Barnum and Bailey's Fair. And they would pay people to go help set up the fair.
Had to be interesting.
Oh, it was interesting. It was interesting.
So now when they set up the circus got all types of people.
Oh,
so.
Yeah. Yeah.
Black, brown, people from overseas, everywhere.
Ladies with mustache and beards.
A sight to see for a young kid,
a sight
kid,
to
huh?
see. Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
And it was set up where? In Recreation Park?
Right here.
Amazing, huh?
Right here. Right here.
I wonder when was the last time the circus was here in town?
I don't know. It was probably when we left. I mean, when they quit coming here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and you know, and what's so amazing, we were in school one day, and they said they had a big snake. It was a railroad tracks would run right here.
Yes.
And they said there was a big snake because a banana train had came through, and we left school early to come up there and see this big snake. And it was a big snake.
You don't recall what type of snake?
No, it was big.
It was big.
Yeah.
In a cage.
Yeah. No, but it was loose. It was in the bananas.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was frozen.
Oh, it overfroze.
Yeah, and they laid it out.
Never heard that story before.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Because we used to have, at Huntington School, they used to bring artists, cowboys, Lash LaRue.
Okay.
Yeah, he came down and he would have his whip, and we had another guy come down with the lariat.
Yes,
he was showing us how to do lariat. It was very nice.
Okay.
You know?
The fun part of growing up in Monrovia.
The fun part of growing up in Monrovia. Okay. Then the swimming pool.
Yeah.
Yeah, we swam on Wednesdays and Saturdays, and they drained the pool.
Well, they said they drained, but they really didn't drain.
Well, we didn't see it.
No.
We didn't see.
That's a myth. They didn't really, because they couldn't afford really to drain it.
Yeah.
It would have cost too much money.
Right.
But I guess to make the, white folks feel safe, they said, we drain the pool.
Okay,
like you're going to get dark if you jump in the pool with black something. People, right? All right. Okay, where am I at? That's why I brought these, to keep up with the world. Yes, indeed. All right, let's tell me something about Huntington School.
Well, you know, Huntington School, that was the first school I went to. I started in kindergarten, and Miss Marug, she was my first teacher.
Was she nice?
Very nice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, all the teachers were nice. And Miss Canali, she was a second grade teacher. And Mrs. Garner, her husband was Earl Garner, and they were divorced. And then after that was Miss Payne.
All right, now let's back it up now. Okay. You went to Huntington School. You was in class with former mayor Bob Bartlett.
We were in class together. We were in class together.
What type of guy was he in class?
Jovial. He was jovial, always getting in trouble. Got me in trouble. You know, a lot
of getting in trouble.
Well, doing things, the teacher would say something, we'd be making fun of. Yeah, she couldn't get anything done. And when it came to the fifth grade, they kept me back.
Why?
They kept Bobby back, and Bobby's mother insisted that he should go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, he went ahead and I stayed back.
But why?
Because I was young at that time, I was real young. You know, I was at the age of, let me see, going into the fifth grade, maybe 12, and Bobby, he was a little older than me. He was older than me anyway.
So they thought you were too young to advance?
Yeah, too young, yeah. And on my report card, it says, talk too much.
Oh.
Yeah, talk too much, yeah, and my mother, she said, well, we're going to keep him back anyway. He's too young to go up there, because my mother was a school teacher.
Right.
She taught me in Mississippi in the fifth grade.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was 5 years old. And so she said, keep him back. So they kept me back, and Bobby was Rancho Cucamonga, because he was the mayor of Rancho Cucamonga.
What a small world. And he can recall you?
No, he couldn't recall me. No. I reminded him of me. And he said, oh, yeah, I remember.
How you gonna forget a black guy? You know,
yeah,
white
that's
guy
right.
In the school.
That's right.
Because my grandmother said if they owe you some money, they won't forget you.
Yeah, right.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Tell me about Clifton School. Moving on to Clifton with Mrs. Cummings.
Yeah, Miss Cummings.
Yes, music teacher.
Yeah, she was a music teacher. She had a favorite song.
And her favorite song was
Old Black Joe.
Old Black Joe.
And she'd come into class. We'd come into class over there, and she said, who's want to pick out a song? And everybody pick out. We'd raise our hands because we didn't want to sing that song. And this guy, Stephen Crow, I'll never forget him. He said, 105, Miss Cummings, 105.
What was 105?
Old Black Joe.
Old Black Joe.
Yeah.
Why did he love Old Black Joe?
I don't know.
Why did the black kids not like Old Black Joe? For those folks out there that may not be familiar.
Yeah, well, it was a racist song. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a racist song.
But she loved it.
Oh, she loved it. We couldn't sing no other song.
At Clifton School, it was always tension.
Yeah, it was always tension because this was the first time that we had integrated into a school, you know, where there was, white kids.
Mm.
And so we had, you know, we hung together for support.
Yes, right.
And
so you guys were like the outsiders.
Outsiders, because they came from Wild Rose, Mayflower, and we just came from Huntington.
Oh, and they knew you, the Huntington folks.
Oh, yeah, because when they were in grammar school, they would come down to play us games, football and basketball.
Oh.
Yeah, Mr. Self. Perry Self, he used to bring out the other kids down, you know, so we could have intramural sports.
Did y'all always give them a licking?
A licking and a ticking. Yeah, we won all the time, and then they would have a little scrimmages after, but they brought them down in the bus.
Oh really?
Mm-hmm.
Escorted in.
Oh, yeah.
All right, tell me about Miss Height, H-I-T.
Miss Height was real good. She was very congenial,
mm-hmm.
and she kind of grouped us together. Okay. And she had us read, we had to read this book, The Little White Indian Boy.
The Little White Indian,
Indian Boy.
Okay.
Yeah, and we had to read that book. But she took us to our house, you know, when we got
ready.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah, she was very nice, her and her husband. You know, but we had to read that book. We didn't think about it.
Yeah.
You know, because it was a very a moving book.
Okay.
You know, a lot of action in the book.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, tell me something about a legendary lady, Mrs. Romney.
Miss Romney, she was a teacher. Mm-hmm. And she had her daughters, you know, they went to school there for a while.
To Huntington School?
Yeah, I went to Huntington School. She was
predominantly big. Black. And
predominantly
brown,
black, yeah.
And Asian.
And Asian.
So people forget that. No Asians?
Mungie Mainwall.
One Asian.
One Asian.
You remember his name, huh?
Yeah, well, we fight every day.
Fight?
Every
Why?
Day.
Why?
I don't know. You know, somebody would say, you know, Mungie can beat you up. And I said, no, he can't. You know, and we'd fight in the alley. They had a little alley there, and
yeah.
We'd fight every day after school.
Every day would be a fight.
Every day would be a fight.
How did it end in the end? When you two guys finally departed and moved on,
well,
when did the fight stop? When did y'all realize, okay?
I think when they brought Mr. Collins and Mr. What was it, Mr. Collins? It was the two teachers from Texas.
Okay.
Yeah, he used to call himself Mr. Soft Touch.
Why?
Because he'd say, you want some grapes? And we'd put our hand in there to get some grapes, and Mr. Collins would quack you across with his ruler.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
What was the point behind that?
I don't know. But when they first came here, Mr. Collins, and I'll think of his name in a minute. Mr. Collins sent a note home to the parents if they could discipline us. And his form of discipline was peddling. He had a pedal with holes in the pedal. You know, and they'd bend you over and pow.
And some parents gave the okay?
A lot of the parents gave the okay.
Were you guys that disruptive in school?
Not after they came.
That put an end to it.
That put everything down.
Mm. Tell me about, that was Mr. Allman, huh?
Mr. Allman, he was the vice principal.
Mm-hmm.
And he was pedal. He'd take you in the bathroom. And I remember one day in class, this guy, he pooted in the classroom. And Mr. Allman said, who did that? And nobody would say.
Yeah.
He said, okay, you guys go in the bathroom, pull your pants down.
Wow.
So we went in the bathroom, and just before he came to me, the guy did it again.
Oh, he got caught.
Yeah, and he said, you guys go back to your classroom. I found the culprit.
Wow. Pass some gas in my class. Okay. All right. Let's talk about moving on to Monrovia High School.
Mm. That was a very eye-opening experience.
Why?
Because everybody was grouped together mm-hmm. for a while. You know, the old seniors, they played jokes on us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Initiation.
You know, they were selling tickets to the tower. You know.
That's the bell tower.
That's the bell tower. You know.
You buy a ticket to do what? To go up there and
just go up there. Yeah, you paid $1 for the ticket, and they got the dollar, and you didn't see the tower.
You got played.
Yeah, but you know, sports, we all grouped together, you know, playing sports. And, you know, during high school, I mean, grammar school, Jesse Otis was our quarterback, you know, in high school.
Okay.
And so when we got there on the C football team, they said he was too tall to play a quarterback.
Too tall, that's ideal for a quarterback.
That's what they told Jesse, he was too tall. You know, so.
So they moved him to where?
He didn't play football.
Wow.
Took away opportunity.
Yeah, took away opportunity.
So he didn't play any sports? He didn't go for basketball?
Yeah, he played basketball. And he ran track.
Okay. All right, now, I got a cameraman out here. I'm getting ready to go to the book.
Go to the book.
As delicate as it is.
It's old.
I'll hold on to it. It's old, but there's a lot of good history in here. You were pretty dashing as a football player, right?
Yes.
All right. Let me get to this page right here and have patience with me. I want to at least. All right. I put the little hot pink spots. And what was your number in high school?
12.
All right. Where'd you go now? All right. Can you get that there, David? Dashing number 12. You love those in rounds. You must have some speed in your days, huh?
I did.
Oh, you could say it confidently, huh?
Oh, yes.
Who was the quarterback?
In high school?
Yeah.
When I played varsity in my sophomore year.
In your sophomore year?
Yeah. They moved me up from C to varsity.
Well, you were pretty tough then.
I was. Weighed 135 pounds.
What'd your parents say about that? 135, everybody else got to be 2-something in the backfield.
My mother said, "You're going to get killed." I said, "No, I won't. I'm too fast." But anyway, Keith Lincoln was our quarterback.
Okay.
Yeah, he went on to go to Washington, and he played for the San Diego Chargers.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk about that in Monrovia. Never known that before.
Yeah, he played with the San Diego. He just died 2 years ago.
Okay, his name again?
Keith Lincoln.
Keith Lincoln. Much respect to you, Keith Lincoln.
Mm-hmm.
San Diego Chargers,
right,
huh?
Right.
All right, now you mentioned the white.
Fun. What is that?
No. Yes. Yes. Oh, God.
Yeah.
All right, now in Monrovia High School is. You have interactions in sports, and then you also start looking at the girls in high school, too.
Yeah.
And some of them are not black, some of them may be white.
Yeah.
And suddenly, maybe romance bloom. Did that take place in Monrovia?
Yes, it did, but that was a no-no.
That was a no-no.
Oh, yeah.
But you can't control love.
No, you can't control love.
Or you can't control hot, bothered people, either.
Right. You know, going back to, say 55 mm-hmm. or 54, go back a little bit further than that.
Okay.
There's a guy, Benny Vance, he used to play football.
Okay.
In Monroe. He was very good, you know, very good. And Benny was dating this white girl from Arcadia. That's when Arcadia MAD was together.
Mm.
And they had they had twin boys.
They got married?
They got married, and they had twin boys because they stayed right down the street from us when I stayed on Evergreen. And shortly after that, you know, I don't know how many years after that, they started Arcadia High School.
Oh, they got to put an end to this.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So how did the students react to it?
Well, I wasn't in high school then, but...
I mean, the community.
The community.
Because they were on the same street, right? Evergreen, they grew up on the same street? Or?
He grew up on Evergreen, but Benny, he moved his wife to Evergreen because the Vance stayed right down the street from me. And they married and he stayed at that house. And... I seen the little twin boys, they grew up.
Okay.
Yeah. And then Benny, he moved to San Diego. I think they moved to San Diego.
Then he died at a relatively young age,
yes.
Right?
Yes, he did.
Probably a lot of stress.
A lot of stress, yes.
Yeah, especially mm-hmm. in Monrovia, right?
Oh, yeah.
Not to mention what the kids went through.
Right.
Wow. And then in 1958, no black teachers at Monrovia High School?
No.
None at all?
None at all.
Wow. So the teachers either at the high school accept you as a person or looked at you as a other? They were either or as a type teacher.
If you played sports.
Oh, if you were special.
Yeah, you were special.
If not,
yeah. Yeah. You know, with speaking of, you know, football, Keith Lincoln, well, you know, I say he was a quarterback, and yes. Freddie Ricks was a linebacker. And we were doing a scrimmage one day, and Freddie popped Keith Lincoln, you know, with his shoulder.
Yeah.
And they kicked him off the football team.
Because of that?
Yeah, because of that.
Stranger than fiction. And no baseball for black students.
In my yearbook, there's one on the baseball team, Vernon Dortch.
Okay.
Yeah, and Ellis Johnson, he was before me.
Okay.
And he was the Wildcat of the Year. And he had his big pitchers in the annual and stuff. And he went out for baseball, and he didn't even have a baseball uniform when they took the pitcher of the baseball team.
Everybody but you, in a sense.
That's right.
But he was a star player.
He was a star player.
But they couldn't find a uniform.
No.
Treachery of...
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, now tell me about Bob Bartlett, former mayor of Monrovia, and his fight with in the quad with Don. Memory lane, come on here, James. Take me down that road.
Bobby, he was tough.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was tough, and he
big guy too.
Yeah, he was a big guy, and he would fight, you know.
Ladies man too.
Ladies man too.
Okay.
And he didn't mind fighting.
Oh, he didn't mind. Huh?
No, he didn't mind.
If you want to bring it, he.
Oh yeah, because you know. Going a little bit further, we were at the drive-in, my wife and his wife, and Bobby, he's sitting down low in his seat, so the guys didn't know what he was, and Bobby was laughing, and so this guy up in the car said, "Shut up that noise over there." And Bobby said, "What did you say?" He said, "I said, shut up that noise," and he went over there and said, "What did you say?" And the guy said, "I didn't say nothing." And Bobby popped him, pow! You know, and the guy got his car started up and just pulled the whole windshield out of his car because the little inside
speaker. Oh, yes, the speaker was still hanging on to it.
Yeah, yeah. Bobby, he was tough.
Okay.
Yeah, he was my friend.
Shades of a bodyguard.
Yeah.
Huh? Okay. Let's talk about after high school. High school, you moved on. What was your first job? Well, you went to Citrus College for a while?
Yes.
How was that like?
It was nice at Citrus.
Okay.
Yeah, it was nice at Citrus because there was a coach out there, Coach Conley.
Okay.
Yeah, and he wanted, you know, me to go to Redlands.
Okay.
Yeah, and I didn't go to Redlands. You know, in 1959, I got married.
Okay.
Yeah.
Pasadena sweetheart?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and I went to Pasadena.
Okay.
College, and I played football over there. And Bobby talked to my mother and father and told them, said, "You know what? We're going to have a championship team over here at Pasadena because we got all of the guys, you know, the veterans and stuff over there." And he told my mother, she said, "I think you should go there." I went to Pasadena City College and we didn't win but one game.
Why?
I don't know.
Was it the coach?
It was the coach.
It
was the team.
Okay. And the players, they just didn't jail.
They didn't jail.
So tell me about Citrus College and Manly Johnson.
Manly taught us our history, because we didn't have any history.
You had the miseducation.
I had miseducation.
And he taught you the education.
He taught us the education.
In what way? What did he bring to you that you probably never heard before?
Yeah. He brought us that black people were something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he told us about, you know, being black and where you came from. Because when we were going to high school, there was two things that we identified with, you know, in grammar school. That was Ned in the first reader was a monkey.
Yeah.
And Blackie was a dog. Mm. And so we identified, that's the only person that we could identify with. And the teacher would, Miss Lemon, she was our art teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And Miss Lemon had us drawing the pilgrims as Puritans.
Mm.
You know, they were all dressed up and,
yes.
You know, and Manley said, that, you know, the Puritans were nothing but robbers, murderers, and whores that they took out of jail and put them on a ship to come over here to tame the land.
Before the Mayflower.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of a book by Lerone Bennett, Before the Mayflower.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting read. Another great book, A Miseducation of the Negro by, it's going to come to me. Any event. Moving on. Now tell me about Aerojet with Bob Bartlett.
Oh, me and Bobby.
You had a interesting path with Bobby, huh?
Oh, yeah, because we grew up, you know, we were just like that. And we went out to get a job, you know, to interview for a job. And they had this guy, he was the HR director.
Okay.
And we wanted a job, you know, a lab technician.
Okay.
And he said, do you have 7 years of college? I said, no, you want to hire a doctor. So we're just looking for an entry-level position.
Yeah.
So we got the entry-level position, and it was a janitor.
Okay.
Yeah, and we worked up, Bobby worked up to planning. You know, I worked up to a lab tech.
Okay.
My daddy worked there. He was a chef.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. He worked up from a dishwasher to a chef. And it was interesting at Aerojet to see how far and how racist they were in hiring practice.
Yeah.
You know, that's
trying to get 1 foot in the door.
Yeah, get 1 foot in the door. All I wanted was 1 foot in the door.
Mm.
You know.
All right, if you're just tuning in, the show is Conversations with Ralph Walker. And I'm honored to have here in the studio James Mikell, the 1958 graduate of Monrovia High School, sharing a little oral history about what it was like growing up in Monrovia back in the days, as we like to say. All right, and then tell me about Edison.
Oh.
Oh, that rings a bell, huh?
I took the examination 6 times before I got hired. 6 times.
Okay.
They would all, you missed
they probably
it.
Knew you were coming every time,
yeah,
huh?
You missed it by 2. You missed it by 1. And then when I finally got hired, they had people that were grandfathered in.
Mm.
You know, the Wichita linemen, you know, they just came and got grandfathered in, but I had to crawl through the hole of a needle to get in.
Yeah.
And it was very, it was good and it was racist.
Yeah.
You know, because I started as a groundman,
mm-hmm.
and I was, you know, supply the lineman on the line with a line, but they had things on the truck.
Okay, tell us about that. I found that quite interesting.
Yeah.
The terminology that they used for it was what?
They had a thing on a truck they call a nigger head. And the foreman one day, he said, go on that truck and get that nigger head off that truck. I said, what?
Yeah, like, what are you talking about?
What are you talking about? It's this nigger head over there. You know, and I said, oh my God. I said, what about? And I said, Richard Johnson, he worked at Edison first, and mm-hmm. he didn't last. You know?
Why?
Because of the racist ways.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and
anything to get you out of there.
Anything to get you out of there, because they had some foreman, they was outrageous. They were
when you say outrageous, such as?
They say anything to you.
Oh.
Yeah.
Fights didn't break out?
No, fights didn't break out.
People just quit.
Yeah, it wasn't nobody but just me.
Oh, God.
and Tom Jones across the street.
And he they would speak to you guys in any type of manner?
Any type of manner. Any type of manner.
So dropping the N-word wasn't no big deal to them?
They'd drop it to each other.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, to each other. Anything come up missing, you know, the Edison Yard was right here on California Street. And if anything come up missing, they said, oh, them blacks, they stole it. They stole the copper.
Oh, okay.
You know, and the people was taking copper anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, the lineman was taking copper.
Mm-mm-mm. I guess they was being nice when they said black, huh?
Yeah, oh yeah. But you know, one night we were working, and this foreman came up, and that's when Orville Farbus was running for president.
Yes.
And he came up and asked me, he said, you gonna vote for Orville Farbus for president? I said, no, I'm voting for Eldridge Cleaver.
Mm.
Why are you gonna do some stupid stuff like that?
He knew Eldridge Cleaver, though.
Oh, yeah, he
Black knew. Black Panther Party.
Oh, yeah, he knew.
Soul on Ice.
Yeah, he knew.
Okay, wow, boy. Tell me about Bobby Polk.
Bobby was my friend, too.
All right, you had connections, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, all three of us, we used to run together.
Oh, okay.
And so I fell. And I tore my quadricep. Mm-hmm. And so while I was off, I wanted to go back to work.
Mm-hmm. And, Edison?
Edison. And Nielsen, the guy, he told me, he was the superintendent of, and he told me, I said, listen, I had some college. And I said, I'd like to have a job in the office over here. And he said, I think you work good with your hands. You can go out there and prefab. You know?
Okay.
I said, oh, no. You know, and so I had a suit, you know, against them. And so while I was off,
okay.
Bobby asked me, he said, you know what? I got a position open as assistant director of Job Resources and Educational Center.
Okay.
And I said, well, you know what? I like that.
Okay. You know, and so, you had the brains to go with it.
Yeah, yeah. And so Bobby, he was very, you know, he was sharp. Bobby was really sharp.
Bobby Polk.
Yeah, Bobby Polk.
Yes. And then they said in 1969, the Arcadia Tribune did a four-part series on this job resource and education.
Yeah.
What was the purpose of it?
You know, at one time, we were hiring more, getting more people hired job placement than EDD.
Okay.
Yeah, because we had a project we called Project Open Future. And we had a deadline to get the project in 3 days. And we went to Job Resources, Dan Fleming, Bobby Polk, and myself, and we put it out, and in 3 days we had it to where it was supposed to go, and we didn't think nothing about it. And then one day, this guy, Rita Rosa, he was from the Council on Criminal Justice,
mm-hmm.
and he came into the office and said, you guys got the project.
Wow, big mm-hmm. check to go with it.
A big check to go with it.
That's amazing.
Yeah, $250,000.
That was a whole lot of money back then.
Yeah, it was a lot of money because what we had a community group and we had a work group. And the work group would go to different employers like the City of Hope,
mm-hmm.
you know, different employers.
Companies.
Companies, and we would tell them, if you would give $5 an hour, we'd give our...
Yeah, matching funds.
Yeah, almost. $10. These youngsters were making $10 an hour at that time.
Wow, that was one way of integrating the workforce.
Right.
All right, now, Watts riots. When that hit, what was going on with you?
I was over there.
You were over there?
I was over there.
Dude, why? What were you doing over there?
I was over there at a club. Right across the street.
You remember the name of the club?
No.
You remember you got out of there, though,
yeah, huh? I vaguely could remember.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I guess the fighting hadn't taken place yet, or you were in the club and then realized?
Yeah, and I looked out the door and I heard some popping. I said, you know what? I said, this was, August? Yeah, August the 15th.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard this noise popping, and I looked out, and there was a Chevrolet dealership right across the street. It was on Figueroa. The club was on Figueroa.
Okay.
And it was a Chevrolet dealership, and they were putting tires on top of the cars, setting the cars, tires on fire. Brand new 65 Chevys.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, some of the viewers have been looking over at this here, talking about the hanging of Mark Allen that actually took place in the city of Monrovia in 1971. A lot of folks try to figure out, what the heck are you talking about? This is some history that no one ever engages in a conversation about. The situations in Monrovia in many ways was a powder keg, liking and to some ways like Ferguson. We don't forget Ferguson already. But Monrovia was pretty damn tough in more ways than one. They used to call Monrovia, Mississippi. Because by sunfall, you better be out of town. If not, your life could be in danger. Now, when people talk about what changed Monrovia, they never say what happened. They say, oh, like some riots broke out, and then everything moved along. There was fighting at the high schools. It was a total chaos in a sense. But they never mentioned the name Mark Allen, a 13-year-old boy, allegedly was trying to steal a leather coat. Somehow he ended up in Monrovia's jail cell, and he was hung. All right. Very few people actually went to identify the body. But my guest here today, James Mikell, was a friend of Mark Allen,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
You knew him, right?
Yeah, because he used to come in and out of job resources.
Okay. Now, what type of kid was he? 13 years old. What was he like?
He was a 13-year-old. Do what 13-year-olds do, yeah. You know, in and out.
Yes.
Yeah. He was typical.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah, always into something.
Into something.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, when that incident happened, where were you at and what was going on?
I was at Job Resources. Bobby Polk and myself was at Job Resources, and Reverend Bailey came by.
Reverend Bailey from Second Baptist Church.
He came by, and that's when we go up with him to the Monrovia jail.
He asked you to come along?
Yeah, he asked us to come along.
Any reason why he picked you two to come?
Because we were the directors of a community agency
there.
Yes. And so we knew, you know, the ins and outs.
Yes.
And so we went to the jail, and they showed us a picture of the body, and there was finger marks on his neck. You could see the finger marks on his neck. And Reverend Bailey, he immediately started crying.
Mm. Now, he was a guy from the South that was familiar with this type of stuff that was happening.
Yes.
So he pretty much knew what may have concurred in the jail cell.
Right.
Now, how was the police department at that time?
I knew two black officers on the police force at that time.
You recall their names?
I know one of them was Mix.
Okay.
Yeah, her name was Mix, and the other one name was William Gay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And now, Mr. Gay, how did he react to all this going on? That ain't his kids found hung in a jail cell. What do you know? Or did he say anything?
He didn't say anything, and he was frightened. You know, he was frightened because we asked him about it, and he was kind of frightened, and he didn't give us, you know, the answer one way or another.
Okay.
But, you know, going back to that, he never should have been placed in the jail cell.
Yes, he was 13 years old.
13 years old, and he should have.
The parents should have been notified.
Notified.
And he should have been released to them.
Yeah, released to them. They should have taken him to McLaren Hall.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at this juvenile justice and pre-adjudication detention.
Mm-hmm.
This is out of the UCLA Alaskan Law Review, 1971.
Mm-hmm.
And they asked some interesting questions. Although adequate detail was paid to the traditional who, what, when, and where, left answers was the ever-present question, why? Why was Mark held at the city jail?
Hmm.
Why was he not released to the custody of his parents? Why was he not previously identified in need of special care?
Mm-hmm.
By focusing upon the rights, remedies, and rationale behind juvenile pre-adjudication detention, this article will attempt to provide legal answers for some of those whys. Now, when the body was reviewed and people left, they shipped the body out, right? After they left the hospital in Arcadia,
mm-hmm.
they got it ready for burial.
Hmm.
So there was no, let's follow up on this.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, it's well recorded. It was recorded in the Black Panther Party newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do the research, in Dick Singer's book, his opening chapter is the hanging of Mark Allen,
mm-hmm.
which I found very interesting. I've been dying to get a picture of Mark Allen.
Mm-hmm.
And if you know someone that has a picture of Mark Allen, I would love to have it to share with the community, because people hear the name and now they know the history of this event that happened. Will Mark Allen ever get any justice?
Hmm.
Is a riveting question. Now, you're the only surviving person
mm-hmm.
that went and reviewed or saw the body. And
no, I seen the pictures. They took pictures.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, I seen the pictures of the finger marks on his neck.
Right. So mm-hmm. finger marks wouldn't come from a hanging.
No, it's...
And then there's another individual I have to bring up, is a guy that lost his eye. He had his eye cut, shot. That was Kurt Davis.
Hmm.
That ring a bell to you?
No.
Yeah. Well, that happened in the days of all that event, all that chaos that was taking place.
What about the Sanchez kid?
No, I haven't. I'm working on that.
Uh-huh.
I'm working on that. But I also know that the L.A. County coroner was Dr. Thomas Noguchi.
Hmm.
He was notorious for not giving accurate autopsy.
Right.
Okay, so he did autopsy on the body of Mark Clark.
Mm-hmm.
So this has been one long journey for me,
yeah.
trying to bring this to the forefront,
yeah.
to give this Mark Allen some justice.
Right.
And people should know the great turnaround in Monrovia happened because of the death of Mark Clark.
Allen.
Everybody had to get involved.
Right.
Everybody had to start saying, let's fix this problem.
Yeah.
And many events came about because of his death. And I'm honored to have you here in the studio talking about it. Reliving that moment had to be very painful.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that has never left me since I first read about what made the riots happen.
Mm-hmm.
No one ever says what happened.
Right.
You have to go to Mark Allen and then you get the story.
Right.
That's how the story begins, on the change in the city of Monrovia, which is, it's like we're going full circle when you think of the lives of Black folks that have died over the years and died currently. And we hear the phrase Black Lives Matter.
Mm-hmm.
And some people don't understand why that is so critical.
Mm-hmm.
That's only because they don't know history.
Right.
Because if they knew history, they would know why it's been said for since we've been here as a people. So I want to thank you so much for making it here to the show. And to the viewers out there, Thank you for tuning in. There's always more to discover when you engage in oral history. So if you know someone in your family, sit down and engage in a conversation with them, because only we can change and write history, the living. All right? So until the next conversation, always remember those stories that have never been told, the time is now.